The extroverted feeling type of person. The feeling type has got feeling as the dominant psychological function, stirs every step in the person's life and makes a mere subordinate of the influence of thinking, sensation, and intuition. Obviously, a typical example is most common among women. As such, I'll try and address this type with the she pronoun, but remember that the less pronounced feeling types can be found in men also. The feeling type has grown up to hone emotional control through conscious will. Similar to the thinking type, whose actions and thoughts are kept in accord with conventional standards, so does her emotions. This is vividly portrayed in her love life, wherein the most suitable man to her is one who's had to fulfill the major collective societal expectations: paycheck size, age, position, reputable family, and so on. You might be thinking this person is too a conformist, traditionalist, and leans on the superficial side, which could be true. Jung, however, insisted on the pros and cons of every type and said that the extroverted feeling types are proven to be motherly women and good companions, provided the husband and children be in character conventional as well. My speculation is the opposite would be a sensation type who's got sensation as the primary function. Joy is derived of aesthetics and variety. Her choice of man therefore would be different, who's unconventional in thought, adventurous in character. Or it could be an introverted type who values subjective standards. We'll speak in depth of those in my next videos. Primarily, and for their contradictory nature with feeling, it is thoughts which are the most heavily repressed processes in this type. This doesn't say a total absence thereof. Thinking simply works in the background as a complementary to feeling. And although it could be clever at times, generally it remains confined around the common and conventional, not so much unique or innovative. What she cannot feel, she cannot consciously think. A person, object, or event that does not string a chord in her will be screened out of perception. An issue, devoid of emotion, full of logic, will be disregarded as well. In terms of choices, decisions originate from what she can feel. Her mood could be neutral at times, which help create a stable space for rational thinking. Feelings are her judgment metric. She will feel, then judge, instead of think things through. And since feelings aren't as static, her judgment is often way too far from reality. Any intense emotion can be of substantial effect on her life choices. This may translate into wishy-washiness, mood swings, unsatisfied deadlines, poor time management, etc. Thus, everything that fits in with objective values is good and is loved, and everything else seems to her to exist in a world apart. First, if the feelings are not in accord with objective values, i.e. common standards, she will not seek out those experiences. The feelings and actions allowed should correlate with what others judge as righteous and socially approved of, or objective facts, observable things. Provided the experience or stimuli goes along with such objective metric, feelings will judge those experiences or events as good, and feelings will emerge therefrom, from those experiences, and only at this point can clear thinking begin to occupy her psyche, which as well takes a conventional character of the emotion that allowed the thought in the first place. When I say feeling must comply to objective values, I'm not saying that some feelings are rejected completely. She can feel the full spectrum, but given she ascribes importance to external opinion, she will merely not seek out experiences which elicit feelings seen as forbidden, taboo, or, for example, feelings of insecurity derived from critical conversations concerning her religious beliefs. Another feature of this type. In spite of hearing a reasonable argument, the fact that it will deviate from a good mood makes her block the information completely. She will try to preserve her mood, avoid the headaches that go into fixing a problem. Also, if someone is trying to calm things down and she feels enraged, she would want to amp things up, try and keep feeling what she's feeling, no matter how much of logic she's bombarded with. If she doesn't quote-unquote feel like it, she won't engage. So far as her feeling allows, she can think very well, but every conclusion, however logical, that might lead to a disturbance of feeling is rejected at the outset. I'd like to point out that apart from the conventional nature of her feeling, it is linked as well to the concrete and to objective knowledge. As far as my understanding led me, I'd say that this type cannot derive emotions from abstract or deep thinking. Anything that doesn't exist outside the mind, that cannot be directly observed, would rarely cause her to feel or think. The external environment of its people and objects, observables, are her primary source of thought and emotion. The disordered feeling type. Similar to the previous type, the thinking type, the extroverted feeling type of person turns into its pathological counterpart when the subject becomes overly immersed in outer objects. It's when this type loses purpose, identity, and ground, is now tossed in between an array of feelings. He, she exhibits a persona of multiple facets, from spiteful rage to cheerful joy at a glimpse. Instead of a subject being in the driving seat of the personality, what has taken control are the feelings effected from externals onto him or her. Some emotions are triggered in quite an inappropriate context, hysterical laughter or the opposite, out of the blue. The basis of the ego always remains the same and consequently finds itself at odds with the changing feeling states. To the observer, therefore, the display of feeling no longer appears as a personal expression of the subject, but as an alteration of the ego, a mood, in other words. The attitude of the unconscious in this extroverted feeling type is that of compensating the predominant feeling by thinking or other background functions. These unconscious compensations often take an introverted guise. Occasional displays of introverted tendencies or styles of thought, for instance. Whenever he or she gets neurotic, depressed, the unconscious turns into its opposite functioning, in that instead of compensation, it exaggerates, even so, the dominant attitude, much like the extroverted thinking type. Depending on the degree of dissociation between the ego and the momentary state of feeling, signs of self-disunity will become clearly apparent, because the originally compensatory attitude of the unconscious has turned into open opposition. This shows itself, first of all, in extravagant displays of feeling, gushing talk, loud expostulations, etc., which ring hollow, "the lady doth protest too much." Now we wrap things up. I summarize to say that, first, the person has this dominant style of being. Usually, he exhibits what he is. What he isn't is still part of him, working in the unconscious background. States of self-disunity occur in times of crisis, depression, or whenever the environment is given too much importance to dictate feeling, i.e., lack of self-reliance. In our last case, I'm saying that the subject loses control of him or herself through conscious will, or by a natural accentuated suggestibility, submissiveness. Objects and others take the wheel. No subject remains, only states of emotion haunting a living body.